How's it going, guys? Girls, hope you guys are having a great week. So it is Friday, guys, so it's time to do my Friday news roundup. I have decided I'm going to continue on this series because I really like the style of it. So this week there's been quite a lot of game-related news, so there's a couple of interesting tidbits this week that I want to talk about. So let's kick this off. Well, first off this week, I want to talk a little bit about Kojima and Death Stranding. So this week, Kojima basically had an interview with the Italian media, and in it they basically talked about the critical response to Death Stranding. So if you weren't aware, Death Stranding released last week, and it released to mostly positive reviews, but there were a lot of mixed reviews from critics as well. So on Metacritic at the moment, it's currently sitting at 83, with 86 critic reviews on there, but the user score is actually quite a bit lower. It's 6.4 at the moment, and that's from 10,229 users last time I checked it. The majority of them are positive, so about 6,142 are positive, 320 are mixed, and 3,765 are negative. Well, basically in this news media, Kojima was asked a little bit about his thoughts on those critical responses and what he thought the responses were and why he thought, there was a lot of critiques of the game and why a lot of people kind of didn't like it or didn't really enjoy Death Stranding. And the response that he gave was so bad. What he basically did is, in this interview, he kind of, well, not really insinuated, he pretty much outright said that the main reason, and he blames the tougher critiques of Death Stranding in the US on American love of shooters, and that he thinks that a lot of Americans don't really understand Death Stranding because it's not a shooter and that's what they prefer and that's what they know. So in this interview, this is a direct quote here, he basically said, "I have to say that the game got enthusiastic reviews, especially in Europe and Japan. Here in the US, on the other hand, we've had tougher critiques. Maybe it's a difficult game to understand for certain types of critics and audience. Americans are big fans of first-person shooters and Death Stranding higher. But I have to say that Italians or French people have a different artistic sensitivity, and that allows them to appreciate this kind of very original product." So in Kojima's view, the reason that it wasn't popular in America has got nothing to do with the actual game. It's got nothing to do with, the gameplay and how a lot of people felt it was, slow and a little repetitive. It's got nothing to do with, the actual critiques and the reasons that they've given for it. No, it's simply because it's not to their taste. They prefer shooters. I don't know what to make figure in the gaming community. There's a lot of people that love him and worship the ground that he walks on, but I'm not one of those people. I can appreciate, some of his work. I really am a fan of the Metal Gear series and can appreciate it. And I have been playing Death Stranding, and I'm about 6 hours in. I'm mostly enjoying it. I can see why some people maybe don't like it. But for me, in terms of trick, and sometimes he can come across a little bit, narcissistic, especially in his games. There've even been moments where he's put himself into the game and as this really important figure. He even cameoed in Metal Gear Solid 5, and I am pretty sure we're going to see some sneaky references to himself in this game as well. I just think this statement really isn't doing him much favor. Now obviously this is a translation. I am sure we're going to get some news in a couple of days time of people saying, "Oh no, it's not actually what he said in Japanese. It's been lost in translation," and that kind of thing. But if this is what he said, then that's really, really bad, and it just shows him to be a little bit immature and really not able to take critical reviews and full-on critiques of his game. Stereotyping all Americans to say that all Americans prefer first-person shooters. Don't get me wrong, first-person shooters are incredibly popular in America, and a lot of games like Destiny and Call of Duty have done very, very well, and they are very, very, very popular. But to say that all Americans like that, that's a little bit, generalizing. And there have been a lot of very, very popular non-shooters that have done incredibly well in America and have proven incredibly successful. Just to name a couple, Minecraft, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, Rocket League, League of Legends, Super Mario Odyssey, Breath of the Wild, God of War, The Outer Worlds, Spider-Man, hell, Pokemon. All these games do very, very well in America and have been incredibly popular, and none of these games are shooters. So it's a little bit simplistic for him to argue that this is the reason. I don't think that is the case at all. I think, Death Stranding is just, very particular taste, and if it's not your cup of tea, it's not your cup of tea. It doesn't mean that your artistic sensibilities are not as finely tuned or cultured as, say, the French or the Italians. It just means it's not your kind of game, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I think, Kojima generalizing and using that as a reason is really, really, really poor, and really poor taste. As well, even if we look on the reviews on Metacritic, a lot of the really glowing reviews, for example, Digital Chumps, GameSpot, these are American critics, so how can you say that, all Americans prefer shooters and didn't really like the game? That's not the case. Even a lot of the very negative critical reviews on Metacritic, a lot of them are Australian, they're not all Americans. So I think Kojima is wrong in what he's saying, and I don't think it shows an ability to reflect on his own game, and he seems just kind of a little bit in his own bubble, in his own world. Obviously, Kojima is a very, very famous, very popular. A lot of people praise him. A lot of people kind of sort of suck up to him a little bit. And I can imagine him surrounding himself by, with people that are just praising him and spouting off, how amazing he is, and all his games are masterpieces, and he's not fallible. He's a human, and of course he's got a creative vision for Death Stranding. Yeah, it's not like anything out there. But the reason it didn't do as well, and some people, didn't like it, is not simply because they preferred shooters. No, it's because they had very serious opinions on it, and some of the criticisms that have been made against the game are, I think, perfectly fine and perfectly valid. And it just depends on what you're looking for in a game. If you're looking for variety in gameplay, then maybe you're not going to find that in Death Stranding. If you prefer things that are a little bit more fast-paced, you might not like it as well. Even the style of storytelling, it might not be for certain types of people. There's nothing wrong with that. There is nothing wrong with that at all. So I think Kojima really has let himself down with this statement. We'll see if he responds to it. We'll see if he says anything, if he actually responds to people's reactions to this, because it has caused a lot of backlash, particularly from a lot of American YouTubers and American critics. So it'll be interesting to see what response he has to that. But yeah, that was the first news story this week, which I thought was really, really interesting. The second news story is Bethesda related again. Just when you think Bethesda can't go any lower, they just do something else that just, boom, knocks it out of the ballpark. Like, seriously, Bethesda, I don't know what you're doing. I don't know what you're thinking anymore. But basically, Bethesda this week, we got some news, which is Fallout 76 related again. Bethesda reportedly banned one of their probably most loyal Fallout 76 players and members of the community. So there was a gamer basically that is well known in the Fallout community. He actually created something called Map 76, which is an interactive map which can be used by community members to help navigate and find resources and items in the world of Fallout 76. Well, he is part of a group And what this group basically does is they test the game, specifically looking for bugs and for exploits, in order to report these to Bethesda. And they're, you know, doing this off of their own back to try to make the game a better version of itself, to make it more accessible, to make the game, you know, engageable and fun, even with all the bugs and issues that it does have. Well, what they basically did is he went on his site on Map 76 and basically said that he had been banned from the game. The basic story is the ban came after a situation in which him and his group found a very serious exploit, which effectively allowed players to easily acquire legendary drops. The player tested the exploit and had one of his group members actually report the issue to a community manager at Bethesda to make them aware of this exploit and how this, you know, was going to ruin the game for players, and you know, to encourage them to obviously fix it. After then doing that, he booted off and logged off the game, and then when he, you know, went to log back on, he basically received an email a day later to say that he had been banned from the game. So I'm going to read you his statement here from his webpage. I'll put the link in the comment section below so you guys can check it out. So this is basically what he had to say about the situation. So someone from my group stated that they had already reported it to one of the community managers in our group. So I just left it. My account got a ban the next day. I dropped the items I got from the purveyor roles, the exploit. It is possible a few were still in the inventory when I logged out from the last test, but I am almost certain I dropped them as well. Of course, I cannot log in to check. Unfortunately, the different divisions at Bethesda seem to have little cross-communication, and the community managers in our group have tried to help us and have had some success, but most of us are still banned. He also, as well, did ask for a refund on his Fallout First membership. He had paid about 1 month of the subscription, and asked for a full refund because obviously he argued that, you know, quite rightly, that Fallout First didn't really meet what was promised. You know, it was false advertising and it didn't deliver on what, you know, a lot of gamers thought it was going to offer. So he quite rightly asked for a refund. Well, Bethesda basically initially turned around and denied this refund. The grounds they used for this was that he had spent some of the Atom coins, the Atom point, which is the in-game currency. And if you have Fallout First, you actually get a certain number of these to spend on a monthly basis. Well, he apparently spent some of these Atom points. So initially they refused him and refused that refund, but actually eventually he was awarded a refund, with Bethesda stating that they had made a special exception. He has actually closed his Map 76 site down and has outright stated that he is done with Fallout 76. It's just really, really sad to see Bethesda act in such a way. Now, obviously, it's not straightforward as we think. Obviously, if he did have those items in his inventory, you know, he says he dropped the exploits, the legendary items. He did say he dropped them, but he can't remember fully whether or not he did do. He obviously explained that he didn't report it himself because one of the members in his team had done that and he didn't feel that he needed to do it. Honestly speaking, if I was in his situation, I would have reported that myself. I would have raised a ticket myself regarding that, just to cover myself, particularly, you know, if I am doing those cheats and those exploits, to try to work out, you know, how people are exploiting the game and where these loopholes are and where these glitches are. And, you know, these people, effectively, they're beta testers. They're free beta testers. I mean, Bethesda, for Christ's sake, should be hiring these guys for a job. They really shouldn't be banning them. They should be hiring them, particularly as they're, you know, quite skilled enough and good enough to actually exploit these and find these out for their benefit. So their decision to even fully ban them is kind of baffling to me. It really is baffling. And it just seems so heavy-handed. did. It does seem that there is a lack of communication between sort of customer service and the community managers that are there interacting with the players and interacting with these groups and these specific players that are trying to test the game and find exploits and glitches and improve the overall performance of the game. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to help Bethesda make this game more successful. They're trying to help make the game fair and balanced, and you know, you've got to give credit to them for doing that. So for them to have Bethesda turn around in such a way and do that is quite sad. Now this guy is a huge Bethesda fan. He has played Fallout 76 right from the start. He's created his own interactive map to help the community. He's quite a large part, plays quite a large role within the community, so it's really sad to see his effort and his time repaid in such a way. And even his last statement at the end is quite heartbreaking. You know, he does say, you know, Bethesda quit giving a shit about Fallout 76 and its players a long time ago. It is time we stopped giving a shit about it as well. Here, I'll start. So yeah, it's really sad to see. Bethesda this year have just outdone themselves. They really have. Like, they're I don't know what's happened. I don't know who's making those decisions in head office. I don't know who is making these choices, but they just seem to make the wrong choice after wrong choice after wrong choice. And I don't see them, you know, regaining that trust. They are losing the trust of their community and the respect of their community, and it's going to be really hard for them to sort of claw that back. So watch this space. I'm sure there'll be more Fallout 76 news in the future, but yeah, Bethesda, well done, good job. So the third story I want to talk about today is of course Sonic related. So we finally had a new trailer for the new Sonic movie, along with a poster which finally shows off the redesign of Sonic. So for those that don't know, back in May, a trailer hit, a teaser trailer, which basically was showcasing the new Sonic the Hedgehog movie, live action movie coming out. Of course, Sonic is fully CG. Basic idea of it is he comes from into the human world. Dr. Robotnik is there, of course, played by Jim Carrey, who I'm really looking forward to seeing what he does with that role. It should be a lot of fun. But the biggest backlash in May was the design of Sonic, which was just awful. Oh my god, it was so terrible. It was like the stuff of nightmares. It was a horrendous design. A lot of people were calling it the Blue Abomination. The teeth were the main thing that just freaked people out, and there were so many memes from it. There was such a huge backlash by the fan base that Paramount and also Jeff Fowler, the director of the movie, actually admitted that they'd made a huge mistake and that they actually agreed that they would change the design and chose to listen to fan feedback and to actually act on it. And I've got to give props to Paramount and to Jeff Fowler for having the guts to do that. They could have done what many other movie studios have done, not change a thing. They could have been like, nope, that's our creative vision, we're not changing anything, that's how we want Sonic to look, and just bring it out, whatever happens. But they did choose to change it, and having seen the new trailer, they made the right choice. Oh my god, the new trailer, the new design of Sonic is spot on. I am a massive fan of Sonic, so I was really looking forward to seeing this movie. And then when the trailer came out in May, I was totally gutted. So when I saw this trailer and watched it for the first time and watched the new design, I love it. I absolutely love it. I think they have nailed Sonic perfectly. He is better in every way. His eyes, his teeth, his shoes, his gloves, his style. He looks like Sonic. It looks really, really good. I love the tone of the trailer. I like the humor in it. We got to see a little bit more of Sonic. We got to see him sort of, you know, just messing around and just goofing around with himself. There were lots of little Easter eggs there, him reading a Flash comic, playing baseball with himself and just having a blast. And I love the humor. And I don't know if it's because it's such a contrast to the trailer in May, but this trailer just seemed like the one in May was like a 2 and this trailer just seemed like a 10, like, because the contrast was so extreme. So obviously, you know, nothing in the movie has changed. It's still the same movie, but obviously they've redesigned Sonic and they've done a really, really, really good job of it. I just hope that by trying to get people's faith back in the movie, that they haven't shown all the best bits in the trailer, because it's a really long trailer. It's like a 3-minute trailer. So I'm really hoping they haven't shown all the best bits in the trailer and that there are still a lot of surprises still to be seen in the movie. But having seen this new trailer, I'm going to go and see it. The one in May that I saw, I'm like, I'm boycotting this movie. I am not seeing this film. Forget that. I'm not seeing my childhood destroyed in such a way. But actually, after seeing the new trailer, I'm sold, and I think it's going to be really, really good. So let me know what you guys thought of the trailer in the comment section below. What did you guys think of it? The fourth and final gaming news I want to talk about today is also related to gaming TV, gaming movies, and this is on the new Witcher Netflix series. So for those that don't know, the new Witcher Netflix show hits Netflix next month on the 20th of December. And we did actually have a recent sort of main final trailer which showcased a lot more, showed a lot more of sort of Henry Cavill as Geralt, showed a lot more of the world. It showed Ciri and Yen in a lot more detail, and it just looks so, so good. The quality of this show looks phenomenal. And we have had a tweet this week, actually yesterday, officially from Netflix, confirming that they have already greenlit a second season. In their tweet, they said Geralt's adventure is only beginning, and confirmed that The Witcher will have a second season on Netflix. That's insane. It's not even come out yet. Like, it's not even come out. It doesn't come out until the 20th of December. And already we're going to get a season 2. Already they're committing to that. And I don't know whether that indicates that they just have a lot of faith in the TV series. Maybe they have a lot of confidence in the show's potential. I can understand why they would. The trailer looks absolutely phenomenal. It looks like the quality of the TV show is very high standard, that they've been very faithful to the books, and it looks incredible. It may also be because of public interest. If you actually go onto YouTube and like look up the trailers, the teaser trailer has 21 million views at the moment, and the final main trailer, which came out I think like a week or two ago, that has 12 million views already. So obviously there's a huge, huge interest in this TV show. There's a massive audience there for it, and they know that they're going to get people tuning in to watch it. So of course the executives at Netflix are very, very confident, so confident in fact, that they've already greenlit a second season. And I am super happy about that, because there's so much scope for storytelling in the books. There's so many awesome elements to the books and so many amazing stories for them to retell. And I'm really excited at the prospect of having like multiple seasons of The Witcher TV series. I'm so happy it's not just going to be like a one season, that's it, that's the, you know, one shot kind of thing. So I'm really, really, really happy to hear this news. In fact, it's made my week. I'm super excited. I want it to be December the 20th already. I will be doing a review of the series. They are releasing the Netflix TV series all in one go, so you can actually binge watch the entire season. So I'm debating whether or not to do it episode by episode, in which case it would take a little bit more time for me to do those, or whether or not I will actually do a season review. Let me know what you guys would prefer to have in the comments below. Do you want an episode by episode or a season review of the Witcher Netflix series? Share in the comment section below. and let me know your thoughts. So that's the news this week, guys. Some kind of interesting news this week. Let me know what your thoughts are, what you found interesting. If there's any news that you've heard this week that you thought was interesting and I haven't talked about, then, you know, get a conversation going in the comment section below. Anyway, I hope you guys are having a great week. I am currently working on my Outer Worlds review at the moment. I finished that game and I'm going to be doing a video, more of a rapid style review, where I'm just going to generally talk about the game and my thoughts on it. And I am currently playing Death Stranding as well at the moment, and I'm hoping to obviously bring out a review for you guys in the next, you know, couple of weeks once I finish that game. But anyway, I hope you guys have a great week, of course. Take care, and as always, happy gaming. Bye, guys.